Hello, hello. How are you? Good to be with CSEA this morning. Got a little something in you? Got a little something in you? Tomorrow Monday, we always start with something, so I want to ask Ms. Yara Allen, who is a theo musicologist with us, who sings, just to do a couple of lines of Ain't Gonna Let Nobody Turn Us Around. Can we do that? Just a couple of lines? Just a couple of lines? Yeah, it's early in the morning, but will y'all help her out? Come on. All right, from right from the floor. Is this mic hot? Keep it hot. That's right.
Good morning. I'm from North Carolina, so we say, hey, y'all.
Hey, y'all.
It is early, so will you help me? So on Moral Mondays, we always stand together. And we just join in song together. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. Gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching up the freedom way. Ain't gonna let nobody. Ain't gonna let nobody. I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching up the freedom.
One time, everybody, everybody.
Ain't gonna let no governor.
Say it. Say it.
No, no, no. Ain't gonna let no governor. I'm gonna keep on walking. Keep on talking, marching up the freedom. One more time. Ain't gonna let no jailhouse.
Turn. Everybody.
No, no, no. Ain't gonna let no jailhouse. I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking. Marching up the freedom way.
That's it. Good morning. I've been on the road quite a bit, so Brother Mike, man, just help me. I'll back off, but I need your help on this morning. Let's first of all give a good hand to your president here this morning. Over 20 years of service. To all of you who have gathered, your president, Saunders, in his absence, who will be here later on today, and my good friend, Bill Lucy, and others who are part of this. Some of you know Roz Pellis, and Roz told me to say hello to all of you this morning. She came down tomorrow, Monday, got involved in one march, and been there ever since. That's how it works in the movement. I'm so honored to be here with you today. I'm here in the city also at Union and Auburn, seminary, and I hope to spend a month or so in sabbatical this coming January, so hopefully I'll get to maybe have break bread with some of you as we're in the city. I wear this stole wherever we go because the extremists back in North Carolina hate it. And every now and then, even though I'm a man of God, I like to be a little devilish. But on a serious note, you know, they ask us, why do we wear our stoles in the legislature? Why won't we just stay in the church? And we tell them, well, the prophetic role of faith is not to stay in the four walls of the church, but to speak truth in the public square. And I want to read something this morning that's a part of that truth. It comes from the book of Hebrews, a time when Paul was dealing with people who were thinking about turning around because some extremists had took over, because there was all kind of political pressure. You know, almost all of the Bible was written by people who were either facing oppression or coming out of oppression. The whole New Testament is about people standing against the extremism and the economic exploitation of the Roman society. Standing against the 1% that was trying to rule over the 99%. That's the whole New Testament. And they were about to quit. And Paul wrote this words. He says in Hebrews chapter 10, now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draws back, God says, I'll have no pleasure in him. And then Paul says, but we are not of those who shrink back unto destruction, but we are those who persevere unto the salvation of the soul. For faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. I want this morning for a while to talk about we must know who we are in times like these. Turn to somebody and say, we must, you must, say we must. You must know who you are in times like these. You know, properly defining oneself and one's nature and one's calling is a critical philosophical discipline that has penetrating and practical implications, both for individuals, for organizations, and for movements. Particularly when one is in crisis or facing seasons of challenge and confronting threats to your existence which seek to take your identity or redefine your identity. Knowing who you are is critical to your sanity and your ability to sustain oneself when facing what Paul Tillich called the very threat of non-being and non-existence. And I would suggest with all of the attacks coming at the labor movement and at civil rights, there is no time like the present that we must remember who we are. We must have the courage to be, even when there are those who have already written our epitaph in the American society. My friends, this is how my black foreparents made it through slavery. This is how my Native American foreparents made it through the journey of tears. This is how my white ancestors, many of them who came to this country poor, made it. As you notice, I just let you know I am quite diverse. I stand before you not ashamed to own any of it. I'm black, I'm white, I'm Native American. I am created in the image of God. On my black foreparents, they made it through. Yes, they were called everything but the child of God by oppressive slave masters and the system of slavery, a system that tried to tell them that God had ordained slavery. But somehow, deep in their spiritual DNA, in their soul place, that didn't make soul sense, which is even in that place of desperation, they were still able to sing, before I'll be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home with my Lord to be free. They knew, despite everything that was telling them the opposite, that they were not slaves. They knew they were not cattle. They knew they were, as Henry McNeal, the firebrand abolitionist, once said, even in slavery, even when you're being oppressed, you have to make the decision of who will be your God. Even when you're being oppressed, you have to decide whether you're going to give the oppressor the license to define you. My foreparents, were creations of God from roots as deep as the Coptic Church of Ethiopian Africa, where formal Christianity was born, or from the deep moral formations of the Kemet Society and the politics and philosophy of Mott, or from the rivers of tribal ancestral faith formations. They knew who they were, and therefore, because they knew who they were, they knew they did not have to accept the definition of those who sought to oppress them. But this exercise in having the courage to be didn't stop with the slaves. Henry David Thoreau knew who he was when he wrote his essays on civil disobedience. In the midst of a society that legalized slavery, Henry David Thoreau said, that's not who I am. And one day he was in jail and his friend Ralph Waldo Emerson came to visit him and said, Henry, why are you in jail? Henry said, because I know who I am. and I know what I'm against. The question is, Ralph, why are you not in jail? In the face of all this injustice, do you know who you are? Sojourner Truth knew who she was when she declared, "Ain't I a woman? Ain't I a woman in the face of the oppression and subjection of women?" Langston Hughes knew who he was, and he spoke to that in a poem, and he called on all of us to know who we were, who we are. I don't know if you've read that poem by Langston, that Harlem Renaissance poet, when he says this: "Oh, let America be America again, the land that has never been yet and yet must be, the land where every man is free, the land that's mine's, the poor man's, the Indians, the Negro, me, who made America, whose sweat, whose blood and faith and pain, whose hand at the foundry, whose plow in the rain, must bring back our mighty dream again. Sure, call me any ugly name you choose, but the steel of freedom does not stain from those who live like leeches on the people's lives. We must take back our land again. America, oh yes, I say it plain, America never was America to me, and yet I swear this oath that America shall be." That's an affirmation of who we are. Claude McKay, another poet of the Renaissance, said, "If we must die, let us die nobly, so that our precious blood may not be shed in vain, that even the monsters that defy shall be constrained to honor us, though dead." And some of that language was how the early labor movement started, when people put their lives on the line to fight for fair wages. Was it not Theodore Roosevelt when he broke with people of his own party and declared, "I know who I am, and because I know who I am, there are four great moral principles of politics: public education, protection of the environment, protection of the right to vote, and protection of labor rights and living wages." That's what Teddy Roosevelt said as a Republican. When you know who you are, you can defy. You can defy even in the face of the onslaught of Freddie Coke in the 1950s, the onslaught of all of his money in the John Birch Society. President Eisenhower said, "I know who I am, and I know who America is," and therefore he said, "We must invest more money in public education than any other president before me, because public education is a matter of national security." When you know who you are, then you say things like Fannie Lou Hamer, "Listen, I'm just sick and tired of being sick and tired." When you know who you are, you can say what the poet said: "Fleecy locks and dark or white complexion cannot alter nature's claim. Skin colors may differ, but perfection dwells in black and white just the same. Were I as tall to reach the pole, or could grasp the whole ocean with a span, I must be measured by my soul, for the mind is the standard of the man." When you know who you are, you can hear what Jesus meant when he said, "You are the light of the world, and you do not put your light under a bushel." When you know who you are, you can gravitate to the lyrics of the song that Michael Jackson wrote before he died, when he said, "We can't go on pretending day by day that someone somewhere will soon make a change. We all are a part of God's great big family, and the truth, you know, love is all we need, because we are the world. We are the children. We are the ones who make a brighter day. So let's start giving. There's a choice we're making. We're saving our own lives. It's true. We'll make a better day, just you and me." That's an affirmation of knowing who you are. And even Bootsy Collins, I know y'all didn't know I was going there, and even Bootsy Collins in Parliament knew the power of knowing who we are, and that's why in code he sought to convert when he said, "Look, everybody's got a little light under the sun. Y'all stop acting like y'all don't know about Parliament. Under the sun. Hear me what I'm saying. I'm going somewhere with this. Political, socially, and community definition and organizational and personal esteem is a critical attribute in movement building. Howard Thurman once said, the disinherited must ask in every age, what will be our attitude toward the rulers? Will they define us? What will be our attitudes toward the controllers of political and social and economic life? How will we be defined will determine how defiant we will be. Now, to be sure, we've always had to fight to maintain a proper sense of self because America has always struggled with knowing who she is. America has had and has at times a kind of split personality. Social schizophrenia, a great gulf in what she dreams to be and what she is. And it didn't start just with black people, it started at the very founding of the Constitution, because we said, you know, in order to form a more perfect union, but if you were white and didn't have land, you couldn't vote. If you were a woman, you couldn't vote. If you were Native American, you couldn't vote. If you were African American, you couldn't vote. So we've always struggled with this schizophrenia. America has defined herself as we the people, as a nation whose noble statement of identity says we hold these truths to be self-evident that all men, right there with schizophrenia, we should have said persons, but anyway, that all men, that all men are created equal, endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that's why Dr. King once said in a critique of this nation that he loved so much, let us be dissatisfied with America until America will no longer have a high blood pressure of creeds and an anemia of deeds. In fact, in his last speech before Ask Me, that's what Dr. King was, the last two major speeches, he was before Ask Me delegates. Dr. King implored us to be clear about who we are in the labor and civil rights movement, and he said you can't ever separate the two, because the only hope for America ever being true to what she said on paper is for working class people and civil rights activists and whites and blacks and Latinos and women and gay and straight to all come together to work for the common good. Dr. King said on March 18th, 1968, 16 days before he was killed, the whole world was against his denomination had put him out. Black preachers were against him, white preachers were against him, the FBI had come in and infiltrated the movement. People were wondering why he was in Memphis dealing with garbage workers, why he was speaking out against Vietnam, that he had spoken out against Vietnam exactly 1 year to his death, right across the way at Riverside Church. And Dr. King said this before 17,000 people, and it was a meeting called together by Ask Me. He says, look, if you will judge anything here in this struggle, know who you are. You are commanding that this city will respect the dignity of labor. So often we overlook the worth and significance of those who are not in professional jobs or those who are not in the so-called big jobs. But let me say to you tonight and remind you who you are. You are those who must say that whenever you are engaged in work that serves humanity and is for the building of humanity, it has dignity and it has worth. That's what he said. Even he said to these workers, He said, even if the folk you're fighting against don't understand it and try to redefine you, you know who you are. The person who picks up our garbage in the final analysis is as significant as the physician that we go to get our medicine. Because all labor has worth. And then he said, just stay with me, Mike, man. Just stay with me. He said, you're doing another thing. You're reminding not only Memphis, but you're reminding the nation that it is a crime for people to live in this rich nation and receive starvation wages. That's Dr. King. And then he made sure that white and black people did not separate themselves. He said, listen, the vast majority of Negroes in our country are still perishing on the lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. My friends, we are living as a people in a literal depression. He says, now you know when there's vast unemployment and underemployment in the black community, to divide us, they call it a social problem. But when there's vast unemployment in the underemployment in the white community, they call it depression. The truth is, Dr. King said, we all find ourselves in a literal depression, and we better unite and fight back. That's Dr. King. Dr. King. When you know who you are, tell them. Bring me up just a little bit. My voice is rough from about 20 straight weeks of speaking. Then on the last night, he reminded us once again who we are. He said, listen, this is the night before they killed him. He said, let me tell you all what this whole thing is about so that you don't get mixed up in your mind. We aren't engaged in any negative protests. That's not what we're doing. We're saying that we're all God's children. And we don't have to live like we're being forced to live. And we've got to stay together and maintain unity. You know, whenever Pharaoh, this is Dr. King, wanted to prolong slavery, he had his favorite formula. He simply kept the slaves divided, and he kept trying to define who they were. But whenever the slaves knew who they were, remembered that they were God's children, whenever they got together, something happened in Pharaoh's court. Because Pharaoh cannot hold slaves in slavery who know they are not slaves. Now, there's been some progress in America, Mr. President, but we still struggle with this anemic condition at times of being schizophrenic. And I want to suggest to you, ask me, and to the NAACP and other organizations, you can't help a schizophrenic if you're schizophrenic yourself. You got to know who you are and know what your purpose is and understand that while you may meet in the Hilton, your real purpose is not to stay in the Hilton. You must get out in the street. Don't get too comfortable. You must know who you are, especially when you're in a crisis of the soul and a crisis of moral definition. And despite the fact that America's defining document says all men are endowed with the right to life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness, and that we're supposed to be one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all, we, my friends, right now, in this moment of time, are in a moral identity crisis. And we cannot help the schizophrenia in this nation unless we are clear about who we are. Let me tell you how bad this crisis is. When you see the aggressive extremism that's occupying space in our political discourse and universe, and that is able often to get 51% of the vote. Let me just break it down. When you can run for office like Tea Party extremists and Coke-funded puppets and literally tell the people what you're going to do to them, and somehow they don't hear exactly what you're saying, you're in a time of deep martyr. All they hear is that you're for tax cuts and you're for against homosexuals and for prayer in the school and against abortion. And they miss what else you're saying and you vote for them. When you can literally stand up and say, give me power. Give me political power. And let me tell you how I'm going to get you to a better America. This is the way we're going to make this country great. Elect me and I'm going to deny public education opportunity. Elect me and I'm going to attack teachers, and elect me and I'll take your unemployment. Elect me and I'll take your earned income tax credit, even if you are a working white person that happens to be poor. Elect me and I'll deny you labor rights. Elect me and I'll fight minimum wage increase. I'll fight living wages. Elect me, and even though people will die Even working people will die. I will deny health insurance, even Medicaid to the poor. Elect me. Come on, elect me. And I'll deny your women's rights. Elect me. And I'll deny immigrants their rights, even in a nation of immigrants. Elect me, and I'll sing, America, America, God shed his grace on you. But then I'll turn around and refuse grace to immigrants and grace to the poor and grace to the sick. Elect me. Elect me. Come on, elect me. That's what they say, elect me. And in a nation that says we have equal protection under the law, I will actually deny that protection to the LGBT community. Elect me, and I'll fight the president on everything. I'll fight him when he goes to war, and I'll fight him when he doesn't go to war. And even though the president deserves legitimate criticism, I'm not going to give legitimate criticism. I'll just fight him on anything. I'll fight him when he wears a tan suit. I'll fight him when he salutes right. I'll fight him when he salutes wrong. I'll call him a thug. I'll call him a liar. I'll call him a communist. I'll call him unfit. I'll call him a criminal. I'll fight his wife when she wears her arms out. I'll fight her. I'll talk about her hips even when she gets ready to give children their vegetables. I'll fight him. Elect me. Come on, elect me. I'm drunk on Tea Party tea. You don't really hear what I'm saying. You don't really hear what I'm saying. You don't hear me. Elect me. Elect me. Elect me. I've been sniffing coke, K-O-C-H, and I'm high. And you don't really hear what I'm saying. Elect me. And I'll support the illicit, you know, elect me, and I'll talk about homosexuals and gay people, but I won't talk about the real sexual sin that's going on in this world, and that is the illicit intercourse between big business and certain members of the Supreme Court. I'll have you over there trying to get in somebody else's bedroom when you don't even want them in your bedroom. But then I won't, you won't, I won't, you won't, you, but I, but I'll turn around and support this sexual relationship between big business and the court that keeps producing the illegitimate offspring of inequality and a malformed democracy. When five members of the court have been the suppliers and the enablers of this political ideology that is constitutionally inconsistent, historically inaccurate, morally indefensible, democratically incompatible, and economically insane, where you treat corporations like people and people like things. Just elect me! And then, after I get everybody mad and after I turn black people against white people and play all of the cards and all of the code words and all of those things, then know what I'll do? Elect me and I'll make it easier to get a gun than it is to vote. That's their whole agenda. And when that kind of agenda can get votes in mass, we are in the midst of a moral crisis of definition and character. And only those who know who they are can challenge it and turn back the tide. And then when you couple that with the aggressive, brutal attacks on black men, that not only should black people be concerned about, but white people should be concerned about. Because when you have officers sworn to protect and serve who use their power to kill and exterminate, everybody ought to be concerned. Because I just want y'all to know, when you have a badge and a gun, and you are the only person that can walk in my house with a piece of paper and extract my wife or my children, and I don't beat you down for it, and I tend to be somewhat nonviolent, but you got to understand what I'm saying. That's the kind of power an officer has. That officer can walk in your house with a gun and a badge and a piece of paper and take your wife out of your bed, and you won't fight them. You'll say, baby, I'll meet you downtown, baby. I'll call the lawyer. When you have that kind of power, you have too much power to be a bigot, to be crazy, and to not know who you're not supposed to be shooting. Too much power. And everybody ought to be concerned about that, white and black. Huh? And when you add to the aggressive, the extremism, the aggressive attack on black men, the aggressive attack on voting rights, and the attempt to suppress the right to vote by, listen, blacks, minority, poor, the poor, women, students. You know, in North Carolina, the voter ID bill that they're trying to implement in 2016, 67% of women don't have it. It's not just against black people. Huh? And when you have in the halls of Congress, to the desk of governors, to the places where state legislators, to the bench of the Supreme Court, unwavering attempts being made to limit participation in this democracy. And when this is happening in a country where justice, general welfare, and the common good is supposed to be our claim to fame, we are in a moral crisis of definition. As one 80-year-old white woman said at a meeting we had the other day, Moral Monday, when people literally don't want folk to vote and are scared to death of a broad electorate, we are in an identity crisis. When the meaning of our creeds have been thrown out, when we have people who want to take us further away from what we said on paper, to what they have said in the back room with their lobbyists and those who are afraid of the diversifying nature of America. Somebody must know who they are and says that this nation cannot afford to go through this schizophrenia much longer. And that's why I read the scripture I read this morning. It was one of the favorites of Dr. King. It said that in Montgomery, when his house had been blown up, and E.D. Nixon, the president of the NAACP House, was bar bombed, E.D. Nixon looked down at Dr. King and said, "So what you got to say now? They're blowing up our houses. What do you have to say, Doc?" And it is said that Dr. King looked at him and said, "No matter what they're doing, we are not of those who shrink back unto destruction, but we are those who persevere unto the salvation of the soul. For faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen." And so there are three things I believe we must know and we must be. First, we must know that we are called to be the interpreters of truth. Tell your neighbor, you're an interpreter of truth. And that means we must tell the truth, that all this language that suggests that labor rights is bad and living wages will break the company and that paying people a minimum wage is gonna have a negative impact on the economy. All these lies are as old as the argument for not releasing the slaves. That's how old they're as old as those who stood against Franklin Delano Roosevelt when he proposed the minimum wage, Social Security, and the National Labor Review Board. It's as old as social Darwinism that says survival of the fittest. It is as old as the white Southern strategy developed by Richard Nixon to get working class white people in the South and in the suburbs to vote against their own self-interest out of the fear that black people would get ahead of them. It is as old as the money changers in the temple when Jesus beat them the hell out. It's as old as those who support voodoo economics and trickle-down tax cuts to give to the wealthy, a philosophy that Reagan and Bush used that got us in this mess in the first place. It's as old when folks say that labor rights and collective bargaining is a bad thing. It's as old, it's as tired, it's a lie. And because we know who we are, we must expose the lies and the distortion. We must tell the truth that the code within the code behind all of this railing against collective bargaining and living wages is this, that black folk and poor white folk are America's problem. That's the code. We must open up. The code behind the code is that welfare not unnecessary expenditure on war caused the economic problems we have. It's a language rooted in age-old race class-based political strategy that turns history and reality upside down. And we must challenge this economic injustice and the lies that purport it. The truth is, America is a welfare nation. Oh, I can't get an amen. You haven't heard, you didn't know welfare was in the Constitution? You didn't know the first principle of our Constitution is to establish justice, and then the second one is to promote the common good and protect the general welfare? How did y'all let welfare become a bad word when it's right in the preamble of the Constitution that every elected official puts their hand on a Bible and swears to uphold? Touch your neighbor and say, don't get it twisted. You better know who you are. Listen, first of all, America is a welfare nation. It was our free labor in slavery that built this nation and created its economy and made it prosper. Don't get it twisted. Then America took this welfare for free, and they took the early labor of immigrants from different countries across the seas, the Polish, the Italians, and others, and worked them in sweatshops for nothing, 80 hours a week. Child labor. America's history is welfare. The first welfare, you want to talk about welfare, the first welfare went to the former slave owners, and the plantation owners were the first one to receive welfare after the Civil War to try to rebuild what they lost during the Civil War. In order to try to put their lives back together, they wanted help from the government, but they didn't want to give the former slave their 40 acres and a mule. So once they got their money to rebuild the plantation, then they started saying around 1880, we need tax cuts. You want to talk about welfare? It was under Franklin Delano Roosevelt's New Deal when AFDC, Aid to Families with Dependent Children, was first developed. But in order to give it, Franklin Delano Roosevelt had to commit to Southern senators that it would only be provided in a segregated manner. Assistance in public housing, when it was first given, only was provided in a segregated manner. The real issue is not who gets welfare or has safety nets in the first place. The real issue is why in the wealthiest nation in the world, people still need welfare. That's the issue. That's what we gotta know who we are. Why are people still hungry and homeless and out of work and out of doors? Why is it, ask the people in the fast food industry, can I work 40 hours a week and still need welfare? That's the question. That's the question. And anyway, I mean, what's wrong with welfare anyway? Why don't you want people to fare well? What's wrong with less than a penny out of every federal dollar going to help people have food and have school and have heat? We give politicians welfare. All those jokers get welfare. Because when they get elected to Congress, they get free health care, free parking, free housing assistance, and they even get free a different kind of litigation, because they can lie and never get brought up for contempt. Get all kind of welfare. We give corporate welfare to banks. When they mess up our money and play schemes with our money and go bankrupt, then we give corporate welfare to corporations that pay less taxes than secretaries and the janitors that work for them. Somebody better help me. Remember when Romney was running and he said corporations are people? Well, somebody has to know enough about who we are to say, wait a minute, Romney, and anybody else that thinks like you, what's wrong with treating people like people? What's wrong? with helping people fare well? What's wrong with believing in that God is a God of pro-helping people? And just somewhere I read that Jesus had compassion one day on 5,000 people that didn't have any food. Somewhere I read that Jesus set up free health clinics everywhere he went. That's why I don't understand these so-called religious right folk that are so religiously wrong that say they don't believe in health care. How can you not believe in healthcare when the one you claim to follow, if anything, was a great physician? Everywhere he went. We're telling all of these religious right folk, if you want a moral debate, bring it on, baby, bring it on. Because there's some of us that really do know what the word says. Truth of the matter is we commit attention violence against the poor. Politicians talk about the rich and the middle class and never the poor. Business leaders talk about the rich and the middle class, never the poor. Sometimes in our union movement, even in NAACP, we don't even want to use the language poor. We have meetings and talk all day about the middle class. Some folk ain't middle class. Y'all forgive me for this, but some folk trying to save their ass. They ain't middle class. They just trying to make it, y'all. And they have to have a place at the table. If we're serious, we must understand that we must challenge this perverse concentration of wealth and power, and we must stand up and say like the Pope said to Rush Limbaugh, when Rush Limbaugh said, you know, the new Pope is a communist because the new Pope is standing up for the poor, and the new Pope said, Rush, you know, he cool. I like that new Pope. He cool, you know. That brother got that Latin swagger, you know. He said, I'm almost through, but he said, Rush, I'm not a communist boy. He said, you what you don't know is helping the poor ain't communism, it's the gospel. Huh? We know who we are, so we must fight for targeted investment in the most hurting communities. We must focus on infrastructure development. We must have funding for educational equality. We must have foreclosure relief and protection from predatory lending. We must create opportunities for the poor community with global and green technology. The wealthy must pay their fair share, not more, just their fair share. We must have tax cuts for truly working people and the working poor. We must strengthen safety net programs and build in opportunities for upward mobility. We must decide it's a crime for folk not to have a living wage and labor rights. Those who know who we are, we must say we can't keep bailing out Wall Street with interest-free loans while poor college students have to borrow money for school at 5% and 6%. We know who we are. So we must say this is no time to repeal health care for nearly 100 million people who are either uninsured or underinsured. Because if you're sick, you can't work. If you can't work, you can't make money. If you can't money, you can't make money. You can't spend it. If you can't spend it, you can't increase the gross national product of America. Come on, y'all. The whole discussion about poverty needs a transfiguration and a transformation. And that is what we are called to do in times like these. But not only in economics, in times like these, we must fight every attack on the electorate. Don't be mistaken. The reason a lot of people are fighting this broad electorate is because they remember 1868, not 1968. I don't have time to go through that, but 1868 was the first Reconstruction. Started down south. But listen, did you know that blacks and white people in 1868 came together? That every legislature in the South was either controlled by a black majority or a black-white fusion majority? Do you know that in the first 4 years, they passed the most progressive laws in 1868 for education, labor rights, health care, criminal justice reform, and fair tax policies? When the former slaves and progressive whites got together, my God. And in less than 4 years, the Klan was formed not to go after black people, but to scare white people away from working with black people. The Redemption Movement. I'm in the wrong century. Then the Redemption Movement of the 1800s decided that they had to stop all this. That the Redemption Movement. This is what they said: we must stop the sin of black and white people working together. They were scared of this. And they said, it's a sin. And so in order to stop that sin, they started a campaign. And they know where they started? Number one, to take over the courts. Number two, they attacked voting rights. Number three, they attacked labor rights. Number four, they attacked fair pay. Number five, they attacked public education. And number six, they attacked any leaders, black and white, who were trying to bring people together. And so when they see, not President Obama, but they see this coalition that brought him into existence, when they see the changing demographics in the North and in the South, when they see a Southern gospel preacher being invited to the what? See what? To CSEA up in New York. And when they mess around and get this film and see all of these black and mostly white people raising their hand and saying amen to a black preacher from down south, they say, oh, what the hell is going on? We got to stop this. They can't, if all these folk vote together, they might mess around and bring a third Reconstruction to America. And that's why the labor movement has got to understand you cannot be one issue oriented. You can't have I hope that during this labor conference, you have had some major sessions on the attacks on voting rights. Because if you don't understand the attack, that the same people attacking labor rights are the same people attacking voting rights. If you don't understand the connection between voting rights and the keeping voting rights open in the South and having a strong labor coalition in the Congress and in state houses, you missed the boat. And the fact of the matter is, nobody gave us this right to vote. Too much blood has been shed. Black blood, white blood, Jewish blood, Mega, Swanna Channing Goodman, Via LaRussa, a white woman, James Reeb, a white pastor, Fannie Lou Hamer. Students were shot like animals at South Carolina State over this right. And that's why you got to understand, my sister, white sisters, where are all the white sisters in that? Raise your hand. Let me tell you something. Did you know you couldn't even sit on a jury until the Voting Rights Act was passed? White women. They don't want us to know this history, because if we understand this history, we'll hook up together. We got to put a different face on it. Down in North Carolina, tomorrow Monday, one day we had an old white lady from Georgia, and we were in a hearing about voting rights, and she said this to me. She said, Rem Barber, let me talk to him today. So you go up there and talk about how these laws are affecting white women. I'm going to talk about how it's affecting black people and mess them up. So she went to the mic. She said, Mr. Chairman, I know exactly what y'all is doing because I'm from Georgia. I've been from Georgia all my life, and I remember when I was a little girl hearing all these plans of how you all were going to keep us from voting. I mean us black people. And the chairman said, wait a minute. Ma'am, you sure you're supposed to be talking right now? She said, I'm very sure because that's my brother pointed to me. Said, that's my brother right there. And when we can get white people talking about racism and black people talking about how these laws are affecting white people, and we can cross switch this thing up, then we can have a real movement in America that will be transformative. So we must use our voices to speak truth to power, and we must fight back. And I read that text to you as I go to my seat to let you know we are not of those who shrink back unto destruction. But we are those who persevere unto the salvation of the soul. For faith is the substance of things hoped for. I want you to know in this convention that if we're here in this moment of time, it's not by accident. We were born for such a time as this. Martin is not alive. Elizabeth Canton Staten is not alive. Mother Teresa is not alive. Cesar Chavez is not alive. Ruther is not alive. But their children are still here. I want you to know that if Ask Me and the NAACP and Freedom Fighters, if our organizations are still here, then by definition of our presence, it's our time. If we're here, it's our turn. And if we're here, it will be our triumph, because we are not of those who shrink back unto destruction. I have a young son, his name is Andrew, who's the smallest in our family. But my boy believes he was born to be here. He lives in the land of giants. His dad is a giant, his brother's a giant, his other brother's a giant. But my boy named Andrew will not shrink back. Sometimes his brothers pick at him, and one day his older brother picked at him and made him cry. I saw it, Mr. President, but I didn't interfere. I didn't call out of order, because there's some times you need to see what's in your children. And I wanted to see that Andrew know who he was. So I watched him go in the corner and wipe his little tears out of his eyes. Kept my eye open. I act like I was sleeping, but I had one eye open. And I watched him how he kept walking around the house quietly but observing. And I watched how he watched until that brother named William that had picked on him laid down on the couch. Oh, have mercy. And I watched how he watched his brother's eyes begin to close because he had eaten a hamburger too big for his stomach. And I watched Andrew be patient, watching his brother's eyes slowly close. And I watched him walk by him and kind of touch him to see if he was all the way asleep. Then I watched Andrew go get him a chair. And he put that chair at the end of the couch. And then he got up in that chair, and then he climbed up on the end of the couch, right where his brother was laying. And then I watched Andrew. I said, this boy knows who he is. Huh? I watched him put up his arm in the position of the atomic elbow. And I watched him bend his knees a couple of times. And then I heard him when he leapt, and he said, my name is Andrew, and I don't ever give up. Boom! What a shock it was to his brother to feel that elbow. And since then, they don't pick on Andrew, because they know Andrew knows who he is, and he never gives up. Well, somebody better go tell the Tea Party and all these modern day oppressors that we come from people who never gave up. You ought to tell, somebody better go tell them they should have left us alone, because there's something about a fight. There's something about struggle. There's something about oppression and injustice that makes us come alive. That's what happened down in North Carolina with Morrow Monday. We decided to be true to who we were. We decided that our place was not crawling in an electoral hole and waiting till the next election, but we had to stand up and be counted right now. We decided that if they were cynical enough to be together, we ought to be smart enough to come together. So we come together, black and white and Latino and Democrat and Republican and gay and straight and people of faith and people not of faith and business people and labor rights advocates and healthcare and education and environmentalists. And we've come together to say we will never give up. They thought they would depress us. But now, after 79 straight weeks of Morrow Monday and 1,000 arrests and 80,000 people showing up in February, the governor, who was at 50% in the poll when we started, is now under 30%. Because we never give up. The legislature that was at 40% in the polls is now at 17%. The Tea Party's numbers have dropped dismally. All the major newspapers that once did said we were just a bunch of hodgepodge of liberals is now saying that our agenda is the only hope for North Carolina. Because when you know who you are, and you are dedicated to ain't gonna let nobody turn us around, then you can help a schizophrenic nation. And what they meant for evil is now being turned to good. And we found out again and again that people drunk on tainted tea can't defeat a sober person who knows who they are. And so if we come together, when labor and civil rights and the faith community comes together, we are America at its best. We are the government of the people, by the people, and for the people. Don't you know the record? Are there any churchgoers here? When Moses knew who he was and stretched out his rod, then the Red Sea opened and Pharaoh was brought down. When Esther and her uncle Mordecai reminded themselves who they were, and Esther came to understand, I was born for such a time as this, then they stopped the plot against their people. When David knew who he was and knew that he had already fought bears and lions, so Goliath wasn't nothing, and he went out there with his rock and his sling and say, I dare you, you uncircumcised Philistine, to challenge somebody who knows who they are. When the headlines were written the next morning in the Jerusalem Times, it said, the bigger they come, the harder they fall. When Shadrach, Meshach, and that bad Negro knew who they were, and they went in the fiery furnace, then God showed up. When the disciples got themselves together in an upper room and God poured his spirit out on them and they knew who they were, then they were able to challenge Roman domination. When Harriet Tubman and Frederick Douglass and white abolitionists knew who they were, then slavery was defeated. When Thurgood Marshall and white and black and Jewish lawyers came together, then separation was defeated. When the MLK and the NAACP and unions came together, then we got the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. When Nelson Mandela and other white South Africans that believed in the possibilities beyond apartheid came together and knew who they were, then apartheid was down. Don't you see? Don't you see? When we know who we are, weeping may endure for a night, but be true to yourself. Remember to you who you are. Climb as high as you can, like Andrew, and declare, we don't ever give up. And if we don't ever give up, if we know who we are, that you are freedom fighters, that you are justice leaders, that you are the labor rights movement, that we are the civil rights movement. If we know who we are, joy will come. In the morning, I've got a feeling somebody in this room knows who you are. I've got a feeling we've only just begun to fight. I've got a feeling if we stay together and march together and vote together and fight together and work together and go to jail together, I've got a feeling everything gonna be all right. Tell your neighbor, look at your neighbor, say, neighbor, don't forget who you are. In times like these, we are who we've been looking for. We are America at its best. Say yeah. Say yeah! Say yeah! Say yeah! Say yeah!